Great steaming lumps of thirk! Kent Hovind's busted out of jail. And what a wonderful gift the Lugermeister gave me on his release. In his very first video, he starts off talking about something that was going to be the subject of my next video, this video.
But if you add up the dates given in the Bible, you'll find what everybody else has found through history that's done this. The Bible dates indicate the earth was created in 6 days about 6,000 years ago. It is not millions or billions of years old. So this top timeline kind of indicates what the Bible teaches. 6,000 years ago, or 4,000 BC, God created everything. 4,400 years ago, there was a big flood in the days of Noah that destroyed everything. And that flood explains all the geology of the world, the canyons, the mountain ranges, the ocean basins, the continental shelf. And we cover all that on video number 5 or 6 of our series, which you can see right here on the YouTube channel. Then Jesus came 2,000 years ago, and here we are today, 2015. Today happens to be July 20th, and the Lord's coming back probably. Hopefully.
Any idea when?
Soon, next 10, 15 years. We'll see about that.
Yeah, that's kind of what fundamentalists have been saying for the last 2,000 years. But credit where credit's due, Kent Hovind's absolutely right. Seriously, if you add up the dates in the Bible, they produce an age for the universe and the earth of just 6,000 years. That's why we know the Bible's full of crap, at least when it comes to scientific details. Because we've already seen in previous videos how 4 billion years of geological history doesn't fit into just 6,000 years, and how 3.5 billion years of evolutionary history doesn't fit into just 4,500 years, and in this video we're going to see how over 5,000 years of Egyptian history can't squeeze into 3,000 years. And unusually for this channel, we're not going to do it with historical, archaeological, or scientific evidence. That would be too easy. I'm going to let creationists argue with themselves. For example, the Fundamentalist Encyclopedia, Conservapedia, tells us the chronology of ancient Egypt, the idea that Egyptian civilization is 5,000 years old, is the least settled of all the chronologies of the great powers of the ancient Near East. Highly dubious at best. Moreover, an increasing body of evidence now suggests that the history of ancient Egypt is shorter, by several millennia, than most scholars have previously supposed. More recent research now strongly supports the original conclusion of James Usher. In other words, it supports Usher's conclusion that the world is just 6,000 years old, and that Egyptian civilization arose after the biblical flood 4,500 years ago. What research supports this? Maybe a paper in the Journal of Archaeological Research, or Egyptian Archaeology, or the International Journal of Historical Archaeology, or World Archaeology, or the Journal of Egyptian Archaeology, or the Journal of Anthropology and Archaeology. I can't wait to find out. Well, if we click on the reference link, we find it's a website run by Creationist Ministries International. This is Conservapedia's source that an increasing body of evidence now suggests that the history of ancient Egypt is shorter by several millennia than most scholars previously supposed. And it's based, as you can see, on biblical stories and what Creationist Ministry International calls the truth and authority of the Bible. Meanwhile, most scholars and most encyclopedias still go with the wealth of archaeological evidence, like this one. Egypt has endured as a unified state for more than 5,000 years, it says, and archaeological evidence indicates that a developed Egyptian society has existed for much longer. And another entry in the same encyclopedia concurs. So, which encyclopedia is it? Wait, what?
Great knobbly plates of toes!
It's Conservapedia, the same encyclopedia that told us this great age was dubious at best, and contradicted by more recent research. And if we click on the link to Egyptian chronology, we come to, yes, that very page. So on the one hand, Conservapedia is telling us Egyptian civilization is 5,000 years old, and on the other hand, Conservapedia is telling us this is nonsense. That's what you get when you try to squeeze things into timescales that don't fit. You end up with your foot inside your own mouth. But again, I'm not going to argue with these creationists. I'll let them carry on arguing with themselves. According to answers in Genesis, the biblical flood dates to 2348 BC. And 160 years after the flood had subsided, according to answers in Genesis, a grandson of Noah, Mizraim, took his family to settle in Egypt in 2188 BC. So when did his descendants build the first large pyramid? No, not that pyramid. This is the first large pyramid, called the Step Pyramid. Answers in Genesis tells us it was built between 2100 to 2000 BC. So the pyramid builders would have started work on it just 88 years after AIG tells us the first family of humans arrived to settle Egypt. So how many people were around to do this? AIG claims that since the flood, the human population has doubled every 150 years. And if you double the population every 150 years, you conveniently go from 8 people on the ark to around 7 billion people on Earth today. AIG calls this estimate very conservative by comparing it with population growth in the modern era. But of course, in the modern era, we have medicine, inoculation against disease, sanitation, welfare, trade, improved food production, and all those things that allow populations to boom. The historical and archaeological evidence shows that from the time of Jesus, it was 1,650 years before the population doubled. So AIG is out by a factor of around 10. But of course, we're not going to use any of that fancy-schmancy scientific or historical evidence. Let's go with AIG's figures. They say Egypt was founded by Mizraim and his family of 8 people in 2188 BC. And AIG says the earliest date for the pyramids was 2100 BC, just 88 years later. And AIG says the population doubled every 150 years. So it's just a simple mathematical calculation. By 2100 BC, there would have been, about 12 of them. Well, okay, let's say they just started work in 2100 BC. They've still got another 100 years to finish the project, according to AIG's date range. So there could be thousands of people toiling on the project by the end of it. No. According to AIG's population growth estimates, the descendants of Mizraim in 2000 BC would have numbered just over 16. Well, AIG reasons maybe they had slaves. Nah, but that still doesn't solve the problem, because according to AIG, the world population in 2350 BC was just 8. So even if the entire world population was involved in building the first pyramid, that's still less than 40 people by the year 2000 BC. Well, surely they had labour-saving devices like cranes and hoists. Yes, presumably they did. But they not only had to move the blocks and hoist them into place, they also had to quarry them and shape them with copper tools, and someone had to mine the copper, and someone had to smelt the metal and make the tools, and someone had to sharpen the tools, which would get blunt very quickly, and someone had to make the dinner, and someone had to grow the food, and someone had to make the tools to grow the food, beginning to look like 40 men, women, and children just weren't enough. To get around this problem, Answers in Genesis does a bit of double bookkeeping. Change the rate of growth to make it fit. So what do we need to build a pyramid? Let's say about 30,000 people. And how do we get from one married couple to 30,000 in just 150 years? Well, you have to double the population every 15 years, not every 150. So now that becomes the rate of growth. AIG calls this probably quite conservative. I'm glad to see there's now an element of doubt in a population growth 100 times faster than the historical record shows. The new figure represents a breakneck speed of growth, and that creates another problem for AIG. A doubling of population every 15 years would mean Noah's 3 sons and their wives would have given us a population of 12 in 2335 BC. By 1885 BC, long before the founding of Rome, the population of the world would be nearly double what it is today, 12.9 billion. And if you extrapolated to the year 2015, there'd be more people on the planet than stars in the sky. We'd be groaning under the weight of trillions upon trillions of people. So how does AIG reconcile these two completely different population growth rates? It doesn't. It's like creative accounting. If people want to know how it's possible to reach a population of 7 billion in just a few thousand years, they're directed to one set of books that says the population doubled every 150 years. If they want to know how it's possible to reach a population capable of building the pyramids in just 150 years, direct them to another set of books that says the population doubled every 15 years, 10 times faster. Just hope no one asks both questions at the same time in the same room. Then we come on to another problem of trying to contort 500 million years of history into just 4,000 years, what on earth are the pyramids made of? Well, sandstone, of course. But this must be some kind of miraculous sandstone, surely. After all, sandstone is made of sand that's compressed and, over time, cemented together to form rock solid enough to support the weight of several tons of pyramid. According to AIG, all the sedimentary rocks we find, including sandstone, were deposited by the global flood. So after the flood, they would have looked like this, soft and wet. So how can they form themselves into blocks of sandstone rock capable of holding up a massive pyramid in just 250 years? Answers in Genesis, as usual, has no answer. The closest I could get was this page, which said millions of years aren't needed for rocks to solidify, just compaction and the presence of cementing agents. Well, here's the problem with that. We know where the sandstone used to make the pyramids was quarried from, and it was near the surface, so it wasn't compacted. And if there were miraculous cementing agents, then how come this sand hasn't turned into solid rock in over 2,000 years? Archaeologists have found tons of sand used to fill in chambers, and they were sealed when the pyramids were built. They found skeletons from the time buried in sand, and the sand is still loose 2,000 years later. Yes, I know, if God could turn water into wine, then he could instantly turn sand into rock. But AIG goes to great lengths to show how the flood, and all the rocks it supposedly formed, happened naturally, without resorting to magical solutions. So once again, Answers in Genesis has no answers. So I look forward to your letters. Oh, and before the creationists out there yell at me for ignoring the explanation AIG gives as to how clocks and spark plugs and handbags and hats have petrified, in other words, turned into rock, in just a few years, I haven't ignored it. I've covered this nonsense in my video, Rapid Fossilization of Hats Debunked. To recap, these objects haven't been petrified, they've had concretions deposited on them in much the same way as concretions form around the sinkhole in your bath or in objects placed in heavily mineralized water. So we have two problems with building the pyramids in a post-flood world. No people and no sandstone. And if AIG wants to argue that there were enough people, then guys, just talk among yourselves. Because elsewhere on your channel, you show very convincingly that there weren't. Ah, but it's not all bad news for creationists. At least you have Kent Hovind back. And on behalf of the atheist community, I'm delighted to welcome him out of prison. Because, as you know, I have a love-hate relationship with creationists. They're so nice and lovable, and they probably feel the same way about us. I'm sure they understand that we could all be friends if only... Well, you know how those dumb beliefs just keep getting in the way. I don't know, I just can't put it into words. Perhaps the best way to express it is in song.
I know I stand in line until you think you have the time to spend an evening with me. And if we go someplace to dance, I know that there's a chance you won't be leaving with me. Then afterwards we drop into a quiet little place and have a drink or two. And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like,
the earth was created in 6 days about 6,000 years ago.
I practice every day to find some clever lines to say to make the meaning come through. Then I think I'll wait until the evening gets late and I'm alone with you. The time is right, your perfume fills my head, the stars get red and oh, the night's so blue. And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like,
this is a dinosaur bone and I want you to carbon date it. They would have said, oh, we can't date that because it's too old.
The time is right, your perfume fills my head, the stars get red and oh, the night's so blue. And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like,
you'll find the maker of the banana, Almighty God, has made it with a non-slip surface. dinosaurs which are having trouble breathing and cause their nostrils to come alight and breathe out fire.